The learning objective of this chapter is to identify and become familiar with precautionary measures for handling vapours in an enclosed or confined space. This chapter deals with the safe handling of the atmosphere inside the enclosed or confined space, and the isolation of the space from other compartments, that is, securing it against hazardous liquids and vapours in adjacent or connected spaces. When opening the entrance to a potentially dangerous space, precautions should be taken in case vapour or gases are released from the space. In some circumstances, such vapour may be released under pressure. Such conditions should routinely be checked as part of preparation for entry into an enclosed space. If fitted and operational, a remote readout from a pressure sensor can be consulted. If possible, pressure should be released in a controlled manner through an alternative route on deck, such as a pressure vacuum valve or ventilator. If a lid or flange is used, securing nuts or dogs should be slackened back gradually and evenly, allowing controlled release of any pressure behind. The space should be isolated and secured against the ingress of dangerous substances by blanking off pipelines or other openings, and by closing all interconnecting valves. Manual valves should be closed and locked where possible. They should be secured by a padlock and chain, or similar means, such as a specialised locking device, a heavy-duty cable tie, or even a numbered seal, to indicate that they are not to be opened. Note that although these are all valid techniques for securing valves, the particular method required by the company safety management system should be used. Warning notices should be placed on the relevant remote control and machinery starting panels. For preference, these should be proper isolation tags, bearing recognised international symbols. The securing and labelling of equipment against inadvertent use and the posting of corresponding warning notices is widely referred to as the lockout-tagout process. Testing and inspection of surrounding spaces should be done and pipelines cleaned thoroughly prior to entry. If hot work is to be performed, then the atmosphere in the adjacent space behind is just as dangerous and must be carefully evaluated. The duty officer should be notified of any systems that have been isolated and secured. Other personnel, such as the duty engineer, should be advised as required. When necessary, sludge or other deposits liable to give off fumes should be cleaned out. This, of course, may itself lead to the release of gases, and appropriate precautions should be taken. Personnel charged with removing such deposits manually should use an externally generated air supply or a self-contained breathing apparatus. Under no circumstances should a filter mask or canister-type face mask be used in an atmosphere which is or may become oxygen deficient. The temptation to enter a space as quickly as possible for operational reasons and irrespective of the continuing presence of any outstanding hazards, must be avoided. And, if necessary, the space should be machine cleaned further to remove remaining residues. The space should be thoroughly ventilated, either by natural or mechanical means, and then tested to ensure that all harmful gases are removed and no pockets of oxygen-deficient atmosphere remain. The time necessary to ensure complete removal of any fumes will depend upon the size of the space, the amount of framing, which may inhibit airflow within the space, the density of any vapours, the level of initial contamination, and the capacity and efficiency of the ventilation system. Only once tested and certified as gas-free by a competent person should a space be considered safe and fit for unprotected entry. Where necessary, pumping operations or cargo movements should be suspended when entry is being made into a dangerous space. Suspension of operations may also be a regulatory requirement, either under the company safety management system or in compliance with local regulations if in port. This is not only to increase the security and isolation of the space, but to avoid additional hazards arising from those other operations. For example, on a tanker, if cargo is being loaded at the time and vapour recovery is not being employed, then fumes are being expelled through the vent risers onto the cargo deck area. If mechanical fans are being used to ventilate an adjacent space prior to entry, then those fumes could be pulled inside the space and render it dangerous to enter. If the vessel is at sea and entry is considered unavoidable, she should reduce speed and heave to, in order to minimise any violent movement, and, should the access be in an exposed area on deck, to reduce the possibility of water entering the space. We have already seen that pump rooms, and in particular cargo pump rooms, require special entry precautions and procedures. During cargo operations, the ventilation will be running continuously, and any alarms will be switched on. However, if the space has not been used for some time, due, for example, to the vessel being at sea on a loaded passage, then this equipment will need to be switched on as part of the preparations for entry. In particular, the fans should be run for sufficient time to allow a thorough exchange of the air inside the space. The Hong Kong-registered bulk carrier, Nigo Kim, arrived off the port of Dampier in the early hours of Saturday, the 17th of November, 2001, and anchored to await berthing instructions. She remained at anchor over the weekend, during which time the crew continued scheduled maintenance work, including the preparation of the interior of No. 1 port topside ballast tank for painting. At about 1300 hours on Sunday, the chief officer tested the atmosphere inside the tank for oxygen content, in accordance with standard enclosed space entry procedures. At about 14:30 hours, the 8-man deck crew started work painting the steelwork inside the tank. One man was using an airless spray painting gun, while the other crewman maintained the paint reservoir, tended a cargo light lowered through the after manhole, and generally assisted the painter as required. Ventilation of the tank was achieved by an open-ended compressed air hose led from the forecastle along the deck and down through this after manhole, and an electrically driven fan positioned at an angle over the after manhole, which also provided access for the paint hose, light cable and a lanyard. The chief officer supervised the initial stages of the task. The paint used was a two-part epoxy mix, thinned as needed using the thinner product supplied by the paint manufacturer. According to the chief officer, the volume of thinner used was between 30% and 50% of the total mixture. At about 15:30 hours, the chief officer went to the bridge to start his anchor watch, leaving the bosun and deck fitter in charge at the tank. At about 16:40 hours, a large explosion ripped through the tank. Three men were blown down the length of the main deck, killing them all instantly. Four others were blown over the side. One man, who had been inside the tank, was still alive but severely burned. He was assisted out of the tank through the ruptured main deck plating and airlifted ashore, but later died from his injuries. A search and rescue operation recovered the body of one seaman, but the others were never found. The investigation concluded that the air vapour ratio, in particular stemming from the paint thinner, had developed into an explosive atmosphere, and that it had come into contact with a source of ignition. It was unable to positively identify that source, other than to say it was within the compartment. The electrical lighting, a VHF radio, or a spark carried down from the electric fan could all have been possibilities, as could a falling tool or a cigarette lighter. It was noted that the prevailing good weather conditions would have increased the temperature inside the tank to around 38 degrees Celsius, which was above the ignition temperature of the thinners, although below the auto-ignition temperature. Analysis of the rate of delivery of fresh air revealed that it was insufficient to prevent the atmosphere entering the flammable range, and that, not being fitted with a trunking to carry the air to the lower part of the space, only the upper region of the tank was being ventilated.